gather to be with others. Here we are together again, just praising the name of the Lord. Here we are together again, just praising the Lord. It's been a while since we've seen each other. Glad to be with my sisters and brothers. Here we are together again, just praising the name of the Lord. Here we are together again, just praising the Lord. My sisters and brothers, here we are together again, just praising the name of the Lord.
Come on, let's sing it one more time.
Here we are together again, just praising the Lord. Here we are together again, just praising the Lord. It's been a while since we've seen each other. Glad to be with my sisters and brothers. Here we are together again, just praising the name of the Lord.
Praise God. Aren't you glad to be in the house of the Lord? Worshiping God with your sisters and brothers. Amen. Hallelujah. Continue to worship with us as we sing.
By you,
we praise your holy name. We glorify you.
Yes, Lord.
You are the Alpha, you are the same. We glorify you. You're the first in our life. We glorify you, O Lord, Most High.
Come on, sing it with us. We glorify
you. We glorify you.
Oh,
we praise your holy name. We glorify you.
You are the same. We glorify you.
that right now. We worship you. Hallelujah. We magnify you. Praise God. Continue to worship with us as we sing.
Let's just praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hands toward heaven
and praise the Lord.
Let's just lift our hands toward heaven and praise the Lord.
Come on, let's do that.
Let's just
praise the Lord.
It's the reason we're here.
Praise the Lord.
We're here to worship
let's
you, Lord.
Let's just lift
our hands toward heaven and praise the Lord.
Let's just
praise. Praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hands toward heaven and praise the Lord.
We praise you.
Let's just
praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hands toward heaven and praise the Lord.
Let's
just praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hands toward heaven and praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Let's just
praise the Lord. Our hands toward heaven and praise the Lord.
Let's just praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hands toward heaven and praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Can we do that one more time tonight? Lord, we praise your holy name, Jesus. We worship you. Hallelujah. 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 What a privilege it is to be in the house of God and to give him glory and to give him honor and praise. Amen. While we're standing, we're going to go before the Lord in prayer. Amen. We have many needs in this house. I'd like to remember my father. He's sick tonight and needs a touch of the Lord. Amen. How many need a touch from God by an upraised hand? Amen. God knows your need. If you'd like to come forward and faith believing, and we will pray with you that God can and he will do a great work in your life. We ask that you would come forward and now as we go before him in prayer. Hallelujah. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we worship you, Jesus. We give you glory and honor. God, we pray that your spirit, Lord, would be in this place. God, let your anointing power set upon us. God, let your healing power, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Jesus. God, we worship
He's
your name,
an
Jesus. Yes,
in
Lord.
God, you know that. Hallelujah. He's an answer in God. When we prayed in Jesus' name and by faith the answer came. Hallelujah, he's an answering God. Hallelujah, he touched me. Oh, he touched me. And oh, the joy that floods my made me whole.
Hallelujah. Can we give a hand clap of praise unto him? Thank you for your touch, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. You may be seated at this time. We'd like to ask the ushers to come forward as we receive the Wednesday night tithe and offering. As we continue to worship him. Hallelujah. Lord Jesus, we come to you once again. Lord, we pray over this offering. Lord, we thank you for an opportunity to give back, God, for what you've given us. We thank you, Lord. Praise your name. And we pray that you would bless this offering and use it for your kingdom. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen.
Oh, I want to see him and look upon his face. There to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, all that last, ever to rejoice. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face.
Hope. Amen. Oh, I want to see him. Amen. And hear him say, well done. Thank God. So good to see all of you tonight on this beautiful, cold, snowy. We thought we was through all that. We was hoping if we could have just got through March. Amen. Well, here we are, and it's good to be in God's house. Good to see all of you here. And I haven't mentioned Marissa has been here for a few services, and we're glad to, Brother Terry Goben's daughter, and good to have her around for a little bit, and it's just good to be in this house tonight. And a few quick announcements. Number one, the youth rally this coming Friday night, and then to the youth, they are taking orders for the T-shirt fundraiser. And they have, I think, 1 week left to order. So see whoever's in charge of that, whoever's doing that. So check with them. And also the Daily Bread books are available if you haven't picked one of those up. And then we do have some flyers we've made up for Easter Sunday for an invitation that you can, if you're inviting somebody, maybe have that to hand to them and invite someone for Easter Sunday. And then 1 week from Sunday, 1 week from this coming Sunday, the 26th, we will have one service only on that Sunday, a.m. only, on Sunday the 26th, our spring break holiday weekend. So remember that. just a lot of good things happening. Praise God. God's good. We've seen some great things, and we've just been rejoicing over these things, and I'm so thankful for what God has done. Amen. If you have and would like to turn with me to the book of 1 Corinthians, I'm going to share some thoughts tonight. As we live for God, and as I mentioned Sunday, we're on a journey. We're going from that destination of the new birth, heading for that eternal home that's ahead of us. And so we're traveling that journey every day. Every day is an experience. Every day is something new and special that we can receive from God. And so I want to read in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, beginning with verse 24. It says, "Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize? So run that ye may obtain. And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible." They do it to receive a corruptible prize, but we do it because we're going to receive an incorruptible goal prize when we get over there. 26, "I therefore so run, not as uncertainly, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway." And I want to take from this verse 25 where the apostle said, "And every man that striveth for the mastery." And I want to just talk to us a little bit tonight about striving for victory. Striving for victory. You may be seated. The church today is positioned for one of the greatest outpourings, one of the greatest revivals that God wants to give. And as we see the church in its position and what God wants to do with it, we as an individual in our relationship with God are moving toward and forward for what God has prepared ahead. And so as we look at these things and understand that God wants to do something great for His church. You know, we're going to bring it down to the individual, but I want to talk to us a moment about the church in general, of what God wants to do and what God is desiring. There's an old statement that used to be made, a lot of been preached about the church, about who are we and where are we and where are we going. The three aspects of the church. Who are we? We are the church. We're the born again, the blood washed, and those that have allowed ourselves to allow His presence to come into our lives. And that's who we are, the church. And where are we in history and in time? I believe we are positioned in one of the greatest times of the church. You know, some people say, "Well, I wish I lived back in Jesus' day." Well, that would have been good. And you know, we all would have liked to live back then, but not everybody back then accepted Him. So you know, it's been great to live back then and see all those things. But here we are in the greatest position because we can look back and see what God has done, and we can see the hand of God upon His church and His people, and know that He will and wants to do a great work in the midst of His church. Jeremiah was prophesying, and Israel had got into a very cold situation. They kind of strayed from God. Israel had their problems. When you look at Israel, you see, you know, they lived for God, they served God, they worshiped Him, and that's the only God they worshiped. And then you'd see as time would go by, they would begin to stray, and the Lord would become very angry with them and pull them back, and they would come back toward God, and then they would stray away. And you see, that was the history of Israel. And they would be there for a while, then they would stray a while. And God was wanting the people that would serve Him and stay with Him. Amen. It was His people, and He was always reaching out, loving and caring for them. And so in the midst of that, one of the times when Israel had gone into captivity and things had gone wrong, God began to speak to them, began to draw them back into that place of favor with Him. And Jeremiah chapter 33, and there's a few verses there. In verse 7, let me go to it. Jeremiah 33 and 7, it says, "And I will cause the captivity of Judah and the captivity of Israel to return, and will build them as at the first." I'm going to bring them back. I'm going to restore Israel. And he says, "And I will cleanse them from all their iniquity whereby they have sinned against me, and I will pardon all their iniquities whereby they have sinned and whereby they have transgressed against me. And it shall be to me a name of joy, a praise, and an honor before the nations of the earth, which shall hear all the good that I have done unto them. And they shall fear and tremble all for all the goodness and for all the prosperity that I procure unto them." God said, "I'm going to just bless them in such a great way and in such a manner that all the world's going to see, and all the world's going to talk about how God has blessed the children of Israel." And then he says in verse 10, he says, "Thus saith the Lord, again there shall be heard in this place, which ye say shall be desolate without man and without beast, even in the cities of Judah and in the streets of Jerusalem that are desolate without man and without inhabitant and without beast." And then notice in verse 11, he says, "The voice of joy and the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride, the voice of them that shall say, Praise the Lord of hosts, for the Lord is good, for His mercy endureth forever. And to them that shall bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord, for I will cause to return to the captivity of the land, and at the first, saith the Lord." God said, "I'm going to bring them back just like they were in the beginning. They're going to praise me. They're going to worship me. The bride's going to worship. And all that's going to gather together and worship God." Here we are today in one of the greatest times. And I know as we look at the hour that we live and understand what's taking place, and there's so much out there, so I can get depressed pretty quick just by listening to some news. You know, it gets pretty aggravating and depressing when you hear just things, you know, that people say, and you wonder, what in the world? You know, we want to move forward, we want to get this thing and all that's happening, you know, to tap into it. And it can be depressing if you think about all the things that are happening. But yet it also is encouraging, because God has put all these things in place. You know, if we understand and believe the Word of God, that God has control of it all, then we just have to accept, well, God, You know where we are. You know what's happening. But He said that there was going to be a voice of joy, a voice of gladness. Amen. I believe the church ought to have joy and gladness. You know, with all the things that are happening around us and in the world today, I believe that people, when they walk into a place, they're looking for something that's going to encourage them. Amen. They're looking for something, a church that's going to worship God and praise God. And when we do that, God is going to draw people to Him. People are going to be, the hungry are going to be drawn to God, because the church is a very vital force in these last days. We are the lighthouse. We are to be the light to reach out to a hungry world. And when the church unites together, when we bind together, and I believe that unity is one of the greatest forces, because when you look through the Word of God many times, several times, it talks about the unity and the body being together. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 1, the apostle writes, he says, "I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with longsuffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body, one Spirit, even as ye are called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, Father of all, who's above all, through all, and in you all." And he goes on to express how that the church and how the body of Christ is united together. And then he says in verse 12, he says, in reference to the Word of God, you know, or the different apostles, evangelists, teachers, all the different ministries. He says in verse 12, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, and for the edifying of the body of Christ. We have the ministry today. We have preachers and pastors and evangelists and local ministers and assistants and all these that minister today. They are ministries that edify and encourage and help the church. You know, whenever someone feels like I don't need a preacher, they are in bad shape, because we need the ministry. I need to be preached to. You need to be preached to. We need the Word of God to get down into our hearts. And here it says he gave these apostles and prophets and evangelists and all these different ministries for the perfecting of the saints, for the edifying of the body. We are blessed when we hear the ministry of the Word of God. We are blessed by it. That's just a principle of God's Word. Then he says in verse 13, till we all come in the unity of the faith, of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto the perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, we come into that unity. The body of Christ comes together. When we walk into this place, I shared a little bit of this Sunday morning of how when the body of Christ unites together, when we are unified, we come together. We may have different ideas and opinions. We were in our men's meeting the other night talking about how we were a people of like precious faith. You know, the men, you know, he was encouraging us, Brother Rich, as far as men, you know, we're united, we're men of faith and all of that. So I brought up, I said, yeah, we may have differences in what ball team we may root for, and we may have differences in our political differences. You know, there may be a lot of differences, but one thing we agree on: there's one Lord, there's one faith, there's one baptism. Amen. We agree that God is one, and we agree that we are going to unite together. Amen. We can have our differences and our own different personalities and all that, but one thing we join together with is we believe in the faith and the power of God's Word and what He's able to do. Jesus, we see a few of His prayers that were recorded in the Bible, but one of His prayers that He prayed was in John chapter 17, and He began to pray, and in this prayer that He gave, and you can read it, I'm not going to read it all tonight, but John 17 beginning with verse 1, and in the process of His prayer, He says in verse 11, He says, and now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to Thee, Holy Father, to keep through Thine own name those whom Thou hast given Me, that they may be one as We are. The prayer that Jesus prayed, He prayed for the protection of the body. You know, when you read the prayer of Jesus, there was many areas and aspects that he was reaching out to and referring to. But He comes to that one point. He says, and I pray that they will be one, just like we are. His prayer was at the body, because Jesus in His prayer understood that if we unite together and we bind together, there's nothing that can stop the church of the living God. Amen. That's why we are where we are today, because there have been people that united together and said, we are going to see the kingdom of God go forward. We're going to see a great church in the city of Portage. We're going to see a great family of God that will continue to grow up in this city, because there is united vision and effort of those of the past and we that are here now that unite together, saying, Lord, You said we were to be one, and we want to be one. And in that process of uniting together and understanding where we are as a church and as a body, the apostle writes and he's encouraging them in reference to their relationship of how it's all done as far as fighting the battles, and he uses that term of running a race. And he says here that every man that striveth for mastery, everyone that strives for victory. Amen. I don't think we started out with the idea that we weren't going to make it. I think every one of us, every person, even maybe those that have not continued their full walk with God, in the very beginning, we all have a determination we are going to make it all the way. I believe every person that steps down to this altar, wherever it is, they find God and they repent, they get baptized, they get the Holy Ghost, and they begin their walk with God. I'm convinced that every one of them, and I'm right in the middle of that too, that when I came to God, I said, Lord, I want to live for you all the days of my life. I want to make it. I want to get through this life with you on my side all the way. And I believe every child of God, every person that has come to God has had that determination. What's happened along the way, I don't know. I don't know what's transpired along the way for some, but I believe everyone had a determination that I'm going to make it. Amen. They said that in their hearts, and then something came along and kind of got them distracted. He says here that every man that striveth for the mastery, if we can just keep, I'm talking about us, I'm talking about me, if we can keep that determination that I'm going to make it, I'm going to make it. What about adversity that comes along? When it comes, just got to make up your mind, I'm going to make it. You know, we've all, somewhere along the line, have probably had discouragements, and we've all been hurt. Honest, in my early relationship with God, I got hurt. There were things that were said. There were things that happened that if I would have allowed it to, I wouldn't be here tonight. If I would allow those words that were spoken, if I would allow those words that were said to interfere with my relationship with God, I wouldn't be here tonight. But there was something, when you come to those points and those situations in your Christian walk, to understand, Lord, it's about you. It's about my relationship with you. It's about my relationship with my God. You know, as a young person, like I said, there were things that were said. We were teenagers, we were young people. We had our differences and we had our own views, and a lot of times we weren't afraid to speak them out. And there were some hurt feelings at times, but to realize that through all of that, there was a determination in our minds that said, I'm going to make it. I don't think I'm the only person that's been through that. I think we've all had it. But there's determination. As the apostle wrote and said, every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Even the mastery, that full command or understanding of the subject, the victory. The mastery, the victory, to be superior over it, whatever, to conquer. Everyone striveth for the mastery. We're going to make it. We're going to make it. We keep telling ourselves, we're going to make it. We're going to make it. I wondered, and it kind of came to mind, how athletes, how they prepare for the Olympic Games. What do they have to do to prepare? Their mental attitude, their physical attitude, all the things they have to prepare. If you're not prepared, and maybe some of you have experienced this before, if you are not prepared to get out there and run on the ball field, and you just all of a sudden jump out there and here I go. If you don't do some stretches, try to loosen up all those muscles, that haven't been used for a while, you try to get yourself ready for it, and when someone is striving, when they're wanting to win and they're wanting to go into a particular sport or whatever it is, there's some preparation. There's things that they have to do to get ready. One writer writes about athletes prepare for the Olympic Games through several years of intense, focused, physical, and psychological training. They work with coaches to determine the ideal training plan to reach their peak performance just as the Olympics occur. They're getting ready. They're preparing. Amen. It says, although most Olympians are born with physical advantages that help them reach world-class performance, these athletes still devote huge amounts of time to training. In all but a few cases, they do not make a living through their sport, and they must find ways to fit an intense training schedule into their lives. They just know, if I'm going to win, then I've got to do this. You know, and so it is in our Christian walk. We say, if we're going to make it, this is what I've got to do. I've got to have a dedication. I've got to be faithful to God. I've got to have a prayer life. I've got to be able to worship God when I have that opportunity to do so. I've got to prepare myself. Every day we're preparing for that final destination. Because the Olympics only occur every 4 years, athletes in many disciplines plan their training years in advance. They want to win. When they go to those Olympics, they want to win. And so they plan, they prepare, they train, they do everything they can to get ready for that Olympic. In our spiritual life, we are constantly preparing ourselves. Every day, we're exercising our faith. Every day, we are running a race. Every day, we're getting ourselves in shape as we live for God and walk with God. So when the time comes, when we run that race and we go through those things and that we have to go through, that we'll have the strength and the ability to do it. Sometimes people come up against something and they just say, I'm just not strong enough. I just don't have the strength to get through this. Don't have the strength to make it. Maybe because of the lack of preparation, the lack of prayer, the lack of worship, the lack of God's word in their lives. Those things may affect that. And so I encourage us tonight that as we are preparing and we're wanting to win that goal, we're wanting to have the victory at the end when it's all said and done, we want to give it our best. Amen. The question is asked, do you wish to gain the prize at the Olympic Games? Consider what happens. You know, they observe the regimen. They must live on food which they dislike. Sometimes you have to eat things. Do you ever go on one of those regiment diets and you have to eat those things you don't really like? And Brother Dwayne was talking about the food they brought into the hospital. I've done that before. At hospital food, after a while, you just say, I've got to have something good. You know, sneak something into me, whatever. You know, but when somebody is in that regiment, they're planning their battles. It says that sometimes they eat food they don't like, and they abstain from the delicacies that they would prefer many times. They must exercise at the necessary prescribed times, and in the heat or the cold, they've got to do it. Doesn't matter. Get a drink, nothing cooling. Take the right things, to eat the right things, to exercise the right way. Everything has to be done right to be able to win that Olympic. They've got to give it everything they have. Sometimes we say, well, I don't know if I can do it that way. I don't know if I can give it all my best like that. I don't know if I can be as faithful as so-and-so is. I don't know if I can do that. All it takes is just that determination that says, I'm going to run this race, and I'm going to win this race at the end. I'm striving. I'm striving for the victory. You may know the story about a lady by the name of Diana Nyad. Diana Nyad is the lady that swam all the way from Cuba to Florida. 110 miles, I think it is. Says that when long-distance swimmer Diane Nyad turned 60, she was determined to complete her life's biggest challenge. In the contents of her phrase, my big break when I turned 60, there was a true anxiety about how much time was left. She got to thinking, I don't have much time left. I gotta do something. It's 60 years old. And her mother had passed away at the age of 82, and she was 60. Diana Nyad was 60 years old, and it just kind of brought things to mind to her. If I'm going to get anything done, I'm going to have to do it. And so she had attempted four different times to swim from the Havana, Cuba to Key West, Florida, 110 miles, and four times she failed. And so she decided she was going to try one more time. She wasn't going to give up. At 64 years old, I believe she was at that time, she decided that I'm going to give it one more try. And in her comments, she said, "You can't find a stretch of ocean more rife with Mother Nature on steroids for a swimmer. As you cross the Straits of Florida between Havana and Key West, it was brutal. The sharks that were there and all the things she had to go through." And they said that the worst thing about her her swimming was the fact that the jellyfish was the worst part of it. She kept getting stung by jellyfish. And so, but at 64, she decided, "I'm going to do it and try one more time." And so it's 2013. This time she designed a special suit to wear to keep her from being attacked by the jellyfish. And she decided, "One more time, I'm going to try it." And so, standing on the rocks there in Havana, Cuba, she jumped into the water and she began her fifth try to swim from Havana to Key West, Florida. What impressed me and what I thought about most importantly is what her motto was for this particular time. Her motto was, "Find a way." Find a way. Somehow, you've got to do it. Somehow, from 110-mile swim from Havana to Key West, I've got to find a way to make it happen. And she said when she jumped into the water there in Havana, she hollered out and screamed out, "Onward, find a way." Amen. She determined that she was going to do the trip and swim all the way, and she did. That was her fifth try. She was able to step on the shores of Key West, Florida. After a 110-mile, 50-some-hour swim, she made it. And because of that determination. And the apostle, not only did he talk about running the race, he said, "I don't want to be like one that's just beating in the air. I don't want to be one that's like shadow boxing. I want to give it my best. I want to fight the good fight, and I'm going to run the race with everything I have. And maybe the motto I could have is, find a way. Somehow I'm going to make it. I'm going to find a way to be able to make it to that eternal home." Amen. Striving for victory. I think we all have that desire to win. We all have that desire to win. We want to be victorious. Amen. Let's stand together. We're on a journey. We're running. We're walking. We're sometimes we walk, sometimes we run, sometimes. But the apostle used the allegory here of running. He used that example, running. We're running this race so that someday we can hear him say, "Well done." Amen. You know, the encouragement is, what we encourage is just keep on keeping on. Just keep on your race. Keep on moving forward. Keep on believing God. Keep on doing what you know is right. And when you do all the exercise that you do, you know, like you say, they didn't always like the food they had to eat. They didn't always like the regimen as far as the exercise and all that. But yet they did it because, and they still do it because they want to win. They want to have victory, and they want to win in those Olympics. Amen. Let's ask God to help us to keep running the race. God, we thank you. Thank you for your word. Thank you, God, for the promises you give us, Lord. We want to keep running this race. God, we want to keep moving forward in our relationship with you. Touch us, God. Help us to be strong. Help us to embrace your ways, God. No matter what happens or comes or goes, our faith will remain in you. In Jesus' name, God, let us run this race with patience, and we can hear you say, "Well done." Amen. God bless you. Pray for our services over the weekend. and pray that God will anoint and bless, and like to see some folks baptized. We got some people that are right at that point, and we just need to pray that God will touch them and see them baptized. We've got some folks need the Holy Ghost, and let's just pray. Ask God, Lord, pour out your Spirit. Let's see new souls buried in your precious name. Amen. God bless you. Shake hands with somebody. You are dismissed.